एवरीवन, टुडे वी डिस्कस अबाउट द फीमर बोन. नाउ फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल वी ऑल नो द फीमर बोन इज द लॉन्गेस्ट एंड द हेवीएस्ट बोन ऑफ द बॉडी. एंड हाउ टू डिटरमाइन द फीमर बोन, विच साइड इज फीमर बोन एक्चुअली गिवन इन योर वाइवा. सो फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल टू डिटरमाइन द साइड ऑफ द पर्टिकुलर फीमर बोन, द अपर एंड ऑफ द फीमर शुड बियर अ राउंडेड हेड लाइक स्ट्रक्चर. नाउ यू कैन सी ओवर हियर द अपर एंड इज राउंडेड हेड लाइक स्ट्रक्चर, somewhat spherical structure, whereas the lower end should be widely expanded to form the two large contours, as you can see. Okay, and over here remember the head is directed medially, okay, and the cylindrical shaft is convex forwards. Okay, so just remember the head should be round and the rounded and the lower end should be expanded. And how to remind the particular right or left side? So over here remember the head should be medially directed, okay, because over here what happens is the particular this head, the spherical head basically forms the hip joint by joining with the particular that acetabulum of the pelvis bone, right? And over here also remember that the intercondylar fossa should be at the posterior side, okay? So by this we can say that this particular bone is actually the right sided femur bone, right? Now how to hold this femur bone in the anatomical position? So the simple way to hold this femur bone in the anatomical position is just remember one thing, that keep the finger or the first finger of yours at the neck of this particular femur bone and try to balance it in your first finger. Okay, because center of mass of this particular femur bone, what will happen? This particular femur bone will actually get balanced in your at your first finger. So try it in the exam, try to hold this particular femur bone, okay, with your only first finger, not your full hand, but just with the first finger of yours, try to balance this particular neck of the femur with just your first finger bone. So whatever shape or whatever posture it will take, it will be your particular anatomical position of the femur, okay. So after determining the particular side, okay, hold it in your right or left hand and just keep your first finger beneath the neck, or we can say under the neck of the particular this femur bone, and whatever the posture this particular femur bone will take, that is the anatomical position. This is the simplest way, I guess. Now next is about the features of the femur bone. Now first of the upper end. Now upper end is basically having the head, neck, greater trochanter and the lesser trochanter, and also the intertrochanteric line and the crest. Now first of all, the head of the femur bone. Now the head basically forms more than half of the sphere and is directed medially upward and slightly forwards. Okay, now basically articulates with the acetabulum of the pelvis or the pubis bone to form the hip joint, and also a rounded pit, as you can see, is situated just below and behind the center of the head, and this pit is known as the fovea. Very important. Okay, this pit is known as the fovea, and over here at this fovea, round ligament or the ligamentum teres or ligamentum teres femoris is basically attached at the fovea. Okay, now next is about the neck. Now the neck basically connects the head with the shaft of the particular femur. Okay, it's very common. Now the neck is actually having, remember, two borders and two surfaces. Now first of all, the upper border. The upper border of this particular neck is actually concave and horizontal and meets the shaft at the greater trochanter. Okay, while the lower border is straight and oblique and meets the shaft near the lesser trochanter. So remember, the upper border meets the shaft at the greater trochanter, while the lower border meets the shaft near the lesser trochanter. Okay, the anterior surface of this particular neck is actually flat and meets the shaft at the intertrochanteric line. And it is entirely intracapsular. Remember, it is entirely intracapsular, inside the capsule. Now the posterior surface, this posterior surface is actually convex from above onwards and concave from side to side, and it meets the shaft at the intertrochanteric crest. So remember, the anterior surface meets the shaft at the intertrochanteric line, and the posterior surface meets the shaft at the intertrochanteric crest. Now very important about the neck shaft angle, very important. Now the neck of this particular femur makes an angle with the shaft, okay, and the neck shaft angle is about 125 degrees in the adults, okay? And it is less in females because of the wider pelvis, and the angle facilitates the movement of the hip joint. Now remember, this neck actually strengthened by a thickening of bone known as the calcar femoral present along its concavity. So along its concavity, there is one kind of thickened bone-like structure known as the calcar femorale. Okay, we actually strengthen this particular angle. Now we have another angle known as the trochanter shaft angle, which is about 8 degrees in adults, and it is an important radiological parameter which actually provides the idea of the direction of the medullary canal and its alignment with the greater trochanter. Okay, so basically very important, actually provides the idea of the direction of the medullary canal. Now also we have one more angle, that is the angle of femoral torsion or angle of antiversion. Now this is basically formed between the transverse axis of the upper and the lower ends of the femur bone. Okay, it is basically about 15 degrees, as you can see in the diagram. Now over here, very important, the blood supply of this particular neck. Now remember, the intracapsular part of the neck is supplied by the retinacular arteries derived chiefly from the trochanteric anastomose. Okay, while the extracapsular part of the neck is supplied by the ascending branch of the medial circumflex femoral artery. Okay, now next is about the greater trochanter of the femur bone. Now over here, remember, this trochanter, greater trochanter, is actually larger quadrangular prominence located at the upper part of the junction between the neck with the shaft. There's a prominence and junction between the neck and the shaft. This part, or the upper part of this junction, is actually having one prominence known as the greater trochanter. And over here, very important thing is that this trochanter has an upper border with an apex and three surfaces, that is the anterior, medial and the lateral one. And over here, remember, at the medial surface, there presents a round impression above and a deep trochanteric fossa below. Okay, so we have a deep trochanteric fossa, okay, at the medial surface, at the lower side, or we can say the lower position, at the below of this particular medial surface, we have a deep trochanteric fossa. Okay, now next is about the lesser trochanter. Now this lesser trochanter actually present as a conical eminence directed medially and backward from the junction of the posteroinferior part of the neck with the shaft. So remember, junction of the posteroinferior part of the neck with the shaft, we have the lesser trochanter. Okay, where the upper part at the junction of the neck and the shaft, we're having the greater trochanter. Now next is the intertrochanteric line. Now this line basically marks the junction of the anterior surface of the neck of the femur bone with the shaft of the femur bone. Now next is about the intertrochanteric crest. Now this crest basically marks the junction of the posterior surface of the neck with the shaft of the femur bone. And over here, remember, there is a rounded elevation a little above the middle of this particular intertrochanteric crest, and this is known as the quadrate tubercle. Now over here, in short, remember that the head of this particular femur is actually having one fovea, depression known as a fovea, and this head directs towards the medial direction. The neck is actually having two borders and two surfaces, upper and the lower border, anterior and the posterior surfaces. Also remember that the neck is actually having three kinds of angle forming by the neck. That is, first of all, the neck shaft angle about 125 degrees in the adult, then the trochanter shaft angle about 8 degrees in adult, and angle of femoral torsion, or we can say angle of antiversion, about 15 degrees in the adult. And also remember, very important, the blood supply of this neck is at the intracapsular region is derived from the retinacular arteries, derived from the trochanteric anastomosis, and the extracapsular part from the ascending branch of the medial circumflex femoral artery. The greater trochanter, over here, the main important thing is that it basically lies at the junction of the neck with the shaft at the upper part. Okay, and this is actually having one apex and three surfaces, especially at the medial surface, that represents a rough impression above and a deep trochanteric fossa below. And also remember, the lesser trochanter is actually present at the junction between the posteroinferior part of the neck with the shaft. Then the intertrochanteric line, or this marks the junction of the anterior surface of the neck with the shaft of the femur bone. And finally, the intertrochanteric crest actually marks the junction of the posterior surface of the neck with the shaft of the femur bone. Now next we talk about is the shaft of the femur bone. Now first of all, we'll divide the femur bone shaft into three main areas, that is the upper one-third, middle one-third and the lower one-third part of the femur bone shaft. Now first of all, in the middle one third of the shaft, there are three borders and three surfaces. The three borders are the medial, lateral and the posterior borders, and three surfaces, that is the anterior, medial and the lateral surface. Now first of all, remember the medial and the lateral borders are actually rounded and ill-defined, but the posterior border over here is in the form of a broad roughened ridge. Okay, and this ridge is known as the linea aspera. That's why we studied about the middle one third part in the first. Why? Because over here you will get to know about the linea aspera. Okay, what is linea aspera? Linea aspera is actually a broad roughened area in the posterior border of the particular middle one third of the shaft of the femur bone. That is linea aspera. Now the linea aspera has, remember, distinct medial and the lateral lips. Now next is about the upper one third of the shaft. Now upper one third of the shaft, there are two lips of the linea aspera. Okay, the linea aspera actually in the middle one third had medial and the lateral lips, right? While in the upper one third of the shaft, the two lips of the linea aspera diverge to enclose an additional posterior surface. Okay, and now as we go over here, the two lips of this particular linea aspera actually diverged at the upper one third of the shaft, and so now we will be having at the upper one third part there are four borders and four surfaces formed because of this diverging of this particular linea aspera in the upper one third part. Are you getting? That means in the middle one third part we were having the linea aspera and the medial and the lateral lip of the linea aspera in the middle one third part. Okay, but in the upper one third part, what happens is the two lips of this linea aspera actually diverges. Okay, and because of the diverging of these two lips, there forms four borders and four surfaces at the upper one third part of this particular shaft. Now over here, the four borders are basically present, and over here the four borders actually forms the medial border, lateral border, the spiral line and the lateral lip of the gluteal tuberosity, while the four surfaces over here are the anterior surface, medial surface, lateral surface and the posterior surface. Now over here, remember, the gluteal tuberosity is actually a broad roughened ridge on the lateral part of the posterior surface of this particular this upper one third part of the shaft of the femur bone, right? Now in the lower one third part of the shaft, there also exist two lips of the linea aspera which actually diverge again over here as supracondylar lines to enclose an additional popliteal surface. Okay, and that's why over here, because of the diverging of this particular linea aspera, there forms four border and four surfaces again. Now what happens over here, just understand that in the middle one third part you are having the linea aspera, right? Now the medial and the lateral lips of the linea aspera actually diverge, okay, in the lower one third part and forms the supracondylar lines. Okay, and these supracondylar lines actually enclose one again surface known as the popliteal surface. And because of this diverging, again we'll be having four surfaces and four borders at the lower one third part. So in short, we can say that in the upper one third part and the lower one third part, we are actually having four borders and four surfaces because of the diverging of this particular linea aspera. Okay. Now over here in the lower one third part, we are actually having four borders, that is the medial border, lateral border, medial supracondylar line and the lateral supracondylar line, very important. Okay, and over here we have the four surfaces over here, that is the anterior, medial, lateral and the popliteal surface. Now over here, remember, told you before that this particular linea aspera actually forms the posterior border of this particular femur bone. So whatever thing I told you till now was about the posterior part of the particular femur bone, right? Don't get confused about this. Now over here, remember, the lateral border and the lateral supracondylar line of this particular lower one third part meets inferiorly to obliterate the lateral surface. Okay, now the lower end of this particular femur bone. Now over here, the lower ends of the femur bone is widely expanded, as you can see, to form two large condyles, the medial and the lateral condyles, right? Now these forms articular surfaces for the knee joint. Now remember, anteriorly the two condyles are basically united and are in line with the front of the shaft, while posteriorly they are separated. As you can see, in the front part they are united, right? But the posteriorly they are separated by a deep gap, and that deep gap is known as the intercondylar fossa or the intercondylar notch. I told you before in the side denomination part also that in the posterior part we're having a intercondylar fossa. Okay, and by this you can determine the particular what is the front and what is the back portion of this particular femur bone. Okay, so the portion we're actually having the intercondylar fossa is actually the posterior part of the femur bone. Okay, now over here we have the articular surfaces also. Okay, so over here remember the two condyles are partially covered by a large articular surface which is divisible into patellar and the tibial parts. Okay, now first of all, what is the articular surface for the patella? Over here the articular surface of the patella basically covers the anterior surface of the two condyles, you can see over here. Okay, and extends more on the lateral condyle than on the medial condyle. And between the two condyles, the surface is actually grooved vertically, as you can see, and it is separated from the tibial surface by two faint grooves. Okay. Now next are the tibial surface. Now what is the tibial surface over here? The tibial surface basically covers the inferior and the posterior surfaces. Remember, it basically covers the inferior and the posterior surfaces of the two condyles and merge anteriorly with the patellar surface. Now the part of the surface over the lateral condyle is short and straight anteroposteriorly. The next are the lateral condyle. Now the lateral condyle is actually flat laterally and is more in line with the shaft. Okay, and over here remember the lateral aspect of this particular lateral condyle presents a prominence known as the lateral epicondyle. So what is lateral epicondyle? Epicondyle, that means a prominence present on the particular condyle. So at the lateral aspect of the lateral condyle, we are having a prominence known as the lateral epicondyle. Now also we are having a popliteal groove which actually lies just below the epicondyle. Now we also have a muscular impression posterosuperior to the epicondyle. Now next is about the medial condyle. Of course at the medial condyle, we will be having one prominent structure known as the at the medial of this medial condyle. Okay, and this prominent point is known as the medial epicondyle. Over here, very important thing is the adductor tubercle. Now, posterior superior to the epicondyle, there is a projection. Okay, and that is known as the adductor tubercle. Okay, and this tubercle is an important landmark. Over here, the epiphyseal line for the lower end of the femur passes through. Okay, and next is about the intercondylar fossa or the intercondylar notch. Now, intercondylar fossa actually, or we can say notch, separates the lower and the posterior parts of the two condyles and is limited anteriorly by the patellar articular surface anteriorly and posteriorly by the intercondylar line which separates the notch from the popliteal surface. Now very important attachments on the femur bone. Now first of all remember at the great trochanter we are actually having insertion of many muscles. So first of all remember piriformis at the apex. Then the gluteus minimus at the rough lateral part of the anterior surface. Then the obturator internus and the two jamuli, that means superior and the inferior jamuli, basically on the medial surface. Obturator externus on the trochanteric fossa. And the gluteus medius at the lateral surface. So remember, total five things over here, the great trochanter, the region of great trochanter, that means at the apex piriformis, at the anterior surface gluteus minimus, at the medial surface, obturator internus and two jamuli. At the trochanteric fossa, obturator externus. And at the lateral surface, gluteus medius muscle insertion. Okay, remember all the muscles actually inserted especially at the greater trochanteric area of the particular femur bone. Right. Now, next thing is about the attachments at the lesser trochanter. Now, over here, again remember all the muscle basically inserted at this area just like the greater trochanter. Okay, now over here remember the psoas major muscle basically inserted on the apex and the medial part of the rough anterior surface. Psoas major at the apex and the anterior surface of the lesser trochanter, and the iliacus at the anterior surface of the base of the trochanter and also on the area below it. So remember we have two muscles over here. Insertion of two muscles, that is the psoas major and the iliacus muscle, basically inserts at the lesser trochanter area of the particular femur bone. Muscle originating from this particular intertrochanteric line. These are first of all the highest fiber of the vastus lateralis muscle from the upper end and also of the highest fiber of the vastus medialis from the lower end of this particular intertrochanteric line. Okay, two muscles, that is the vastus lateralis and vastus medialis, from the upper and the lower end of the intertrochanteric line respectively. Okay. Now next is the quadrate tubercle. Now this tubercle actually gives insertion to the quadratus femoris muscle. Okay. Now next are the attachment of the shaft of the particular femur bone. Now first of all, there is origin of the medial head of the gastrocnemius muscle, basically at the popliteal surface. Now next is the vastus intermedius. Now this muscle basically originates, or we can say arises, from the upper 3/4 of the anterior and the lateral surface. The articularis genu arises just below the vastus intermedius. Of course, that means vastus intermedius basically arises from the upper 3/4 of the anterior surface and also from the lateral surface. So just below this anterior and the lateral surface of this particular shaft, we are actually having the articularis genu. Now next is the vastus lateralis muscle. Now to remember the particular series of this particular vastus lateralis muscle origin, just go on the way I am saying. Just remember that first of all, the vastus lateralis muscle basically originates firstly from the upper part of the intertrochanteric line. Okay. Now after originating from this particular intertrochanteric line, this vastus lateralis muscle will actually go upward. Okay. And will actually get originated from the anterior and the inferior aspects of the greater trochanter. Okay. And now then it will go a little backward direction. Okay. And then we get attached, or we can say originate, at the lateral margin of the gluteal tuberosity. Okay. And then it will go backward again. Okay. And basically originates at the upper half of the lateral lip of the linea aspera. Are you getting? That means we have to go from forward to behind direction. By this way only you can easily remember the particular origin of this particular vastus lateralis. Okay. What happens? First of all, the upper part of the intertrochanteric line, that will go again upward and gets originated from the greater trochanter, especially at the anterior and the inferior aspect of this particular greater trochanter, and they will go upward and backward and originates at the lateral margin of the particular gluteal tuberosity, and then again goes backward and gets originated at the upper half of the lateral lip of the linea aspera. So remember, in this series you will never forget this particular origin. Now next is about the vastus medialis. Now just do the same thing over here, or just go on the way I'm saying. First of all, arising from the lower part of the intertrochanteric line. Okay, then go to the spiral line, then the medial lip of the linea aspera, and finally at the medial supracondylar line. So what happened over here? First of all, at the lower part of the intertrochanteric line, and then it will go on to the spiral line. That means going from forward to the backward surface. Okay, and then at the medial lip of the linea aspera, and then finally at the medial supracondylar line. So just remember in the series, just draw a diagram, we can say, just draw a diagram in the series. So you'll be able to remember this particular series in a very easier manner. Okay. Now next is about the gluteus maximus. Now over here, remember the gluteus maximus basically inserted into the gluteal tuberosity. Now at the longest muscle, this muscle basically inserted along the medial lip of the linea aspera. Okay. Between the vastus medialis and the adductor brevis and adductor magnus. Adductor brevis basically inserts into a line extending from the lesser trochanter to the upper part of the linea aspera. Adductor magnus inserts into the medial margin of the gluteal tuberosity, then the linea aspera, then the medial supracondylar line, and finally at the adductor tubercle. So you have to do the same thing over here we did with the vastus lateralis and the vastus medialis. What we did over there? We just drew a diagram over there, right? We just drew a line, we can say. So just draw a simple line of this all the particular origin insertion. Okay, at the end you will be easily able to understand this particular attachments. Now pectineus muscle inserted on the line extending from the lesser trochanter to the linea aspera. Then the short head of biceps femoris arises from the lateral lip of the linea aspera between the vastus lateralis and the adductor magnus, and from the upper 2/3 of the lateral supracondylar line. Now look at this diagram over here. So it will be easier for you to remember the particular insertion, or we can say the series of insertion and the origin of the particular muscles at the linea aspera. Okay, particularly the linea aspera. So as you can see over here, the most medially there will be origin of the vastus medialis muscle. Remember, this particular diagram is only for the linea aspera. Okay, but the way I told you, remember, just do it in that way, it will be easier for you to remember the attachments. Means just draw one single one, just draw the particular line or the diagram for the particular series of the origin, the insertion of the particular muscle, right? So the linear, as far as I remember, the medial most one is the vastus medialis. Then we'll go slowly to the lateral side. There will be the erector longus, then the erector brevis, then erector magnus, then short head of biceps, and finally there will be the vastus lateralis muscle origin. Okay. So now next is about the plantaris muscle. So here the lower end of the lateral supracondylar line gives origin to the plantaris muscle above, and the upper part of the lateral head of the gastrocnemius muscle below. Okay. Now next is attachments at the lateral condyle. Remember, there will be attachments of basically two muscles, and such the origin of this particular two muscles. First of all, the popliteus muscle. Now the popliteus muscle basically originates from the deep anterior part of the popliteal groove. Okay, and the lateral head of gastrocnemius actually originates from the muscular impression near the lateral epicondyle. Okay, now the attachment on the medial condyle. Now over here, remember the ischial head of the erector magnus. If you remember, in the erector magnus muscle, okay, we have two basic heads, that is the adductor head and the ischial head. So over here, remember the ischial head, or because the hamstring head or hamstring part of the erector magnus basically gets inserted at the adductor tubercle. Okay. The first of the fracture of this particular shaft of the femur bone is common in the children below the 16 age, because at this, up till this age, this particular femur bone is not well developed. Okay, but after the 60, we can say at the adult stage, only after severe accidents, okay, the particular femur bone will actually damage. And also above the age of 60, because of the osteoporosis and any kind of other bone degeneration and the bone weakness, the fracture of the neck of the femur bone may occur. And this neck of the femur bone fracture is actually common in the females due to the osteoporosis and degeneration of the calcar femorale. Now also remember, the head of the femur is partly supplied by a branch of the obturator artery along the ligamentum teres, and main arterial supply is from the retinacular arteries, branches of the medial femoral circumflex artery. We discussed about this before also, right? Now these artery gets injured in intracapsular fracture of the neck of the femur, leading to the avascular necrosis of the head. Now next is about the Q angle. Very important question. What is the Q angle? Now in the normal knee, the obliquity of the line of the quadriceps muscle and its insertion into the tibia results in an angle known as the Q angle. Okay, and this Q angle is normally about 15 to 20 degrees. Okay, and if the angle of this particular, if the Q angle actually increased, there may be lateral subluxation of the patella. So this was all about the femur bone. I hope you enjoyed it well. Thank you so much.